Each candidate will speak for 5 minutes as an opening speech about why you should vote for them. Then we will go to questions. All the questions have been submitted in advance. I will call out your number and your name. If you stand, a microphone will come to you and ask your question. Each candidate will have the opportunity to answer. At the end of the proceedings, each candidate will have the opportunity to speak for 2 minutes in reverse order to their opening speeches. And I hope we're finished by about 8:45 at the latest. First to speak will be Marisha, who is the Liberal Democrat. Hold on a sec, who is the Liberal Democrat candidate. Second will be Emma, who is the Labour candidate. Third will be Phil, who is the Green Party candidate. And fourth will be Theresa, who is the Conservative Party candidate. Marisha, would you like to come and give your opening speech?
I am Marisha Ray, standing to be your Liberal Democrat MP to change Britain's future, to make a brighter and better future. Seldom have other parties' policies so threatened our prosperity, threatening our economy, which pays for our children's education, our social care, our health service, our local government service, and our libraries, even threatening the homes of our older residents. But we know that it also threatens the spirit, the way in which Britain has been up till now. There is no doubt about the fact that dabbling with an extreme Brexit, we are handing a blank cheque to the government. We the people deserve a say on the final Brexit deal and the impact it will have on our country when that is known. I care deeply that we treat people decently in a humane way in our country and care for the global environment. I care that our businesses, which drive our economy, have the conditions they need to continue to thrive. I care deeply that our NHS and social care is properly funded, and I will fight the dementia tax. We all paid our dues. I care deeply that pensions for all and pay for teachers, nurses and all public sector workers rise in line with the cost of living. I care deeply that our children get the best start in life. I oppose the Conservative Party's cuts, which they've already voted through. I care deeply that we have extra investment in childcare and no cuts at all at our schools, reversing those that have taken place. My opponent urges wrenching Britain from the single market, from the customs union that we've benefited from almost all my life. As one of the most successful members of that single market and customs union, do you perhaps take our prosperity and how much that depends upon that for granted? No one voted for a poorer nation and worse public services last June. You deserve a government and an opposition that listens, respects evidence, thinks rigorously, builds a consensus, and strives to make Britain more united, more prosperous, a country happier with itself and those around it. I've worked in research and innovation, an area which drives our economy and is already hit by Brexit. I've worked in corporate information technology, neglected, and you bring organisations to their knees instantly. I've worked hard as a leading councillor in the North London Authority, working on all local government services and local authority pension fund. I'm a school governor for a primary school and have been a comprehensive secondary school governor too. I've been an active member of the governing body of one of London's major universities. I understand the implications of Brexit on the university sector, and it is my job here tonight to make sure that we all do. I know firsthand about the integration of health and social care services, so important for our older residents. And I understand firsthand from my work with a London hospital how important it is that we fund our NHS, that we reverse cuts, that we pay our staff properly and are able to recruit skilled staff from wherever we need to, when we need to. I know what happens when we are not able to do so because of tight restrictions on immigration. I know that you want our health service to have staff, to have funds, and to be a decent place to work. I have even worked on improving London's economy, making our city's prosperity accessible to all our residents, enabling new businesses to thrive. If you want a say on the final Brexit deal and an effective MP who listens to you and represents your views, if you want to secure that future and that of your family and community, vote for Marie Charette, your Liberal Democrat candidate, next Thursday, the 8th of June. Thank you very much.
In short, I'm a North London girl. I grew up and spent the last 34 years of my life based in Muswell Hill, just down the road. I was born and raised there by two teachers who worked hard to give me the opportunities that I've had, and I've been incredibly lucky to have those opportunities. But I had those because they instilled me with the values that they had of hard work, of commitment to my community, and of giving back. And that's why I want to be your MP. I'm now a lawyer and I spend all of my working life representing people at court, meeting them, talking about their problems, understanding what they want, and getting the result they need. And that is, those are the skills and that is the essence of why I want to be your MP. I have those skills. I've been honing them my entire working life. I was doing the same thing as a university student and as a school student, representing people, giving back my entire life. And that is why I want to represent you. I want to listen to what it is that concerns you. I want to understand how I can help you to fix it. And I want to go to Parliament and show people that we can make a difference and we can achieve things when we work together. Everyone who is born and lives in Barnet should have the opportunities that I had. And it shouldn't be, as I said, about luck. It should be that they have an equal playing field on which they can achieve. And that is what, as a Labour Party, we believe you should be able to give your children. When this election was called, Theresa May said it was the most important election of her lifetime. And I think that's probably the last time she said something that she hasn't U-turned on. And it's probably the only thing she said in this election that I agree with. Because it is the most important election of our lifetimes. And not just because of Brexit. Yes, we're going to have to decide what deal we want. Yes, we're going to have to negotiate. And I would negotiate with the interests of both the Remainers and the people who voted Leave. This has got to be a compromise. This country was deeply divided last summer when we got that result. Our communities torn apart, families taking different sides of this argument, and we have to find a way to come back together. But that deal has to work for us as a country. We as a Labour Party have set down six very tough tests that we want that deal to make. But they're not lines in the sand. We're not making demands. We're making principles, ideas that we want the deal to meet. And that is what we will measure our success against. But it's not just Brexit. There's never been a more stark choice before the electorate as to the future they want for this country. We are the fifth richest country on the earth, yet under Conservative government, and before that under the Conservative Liberal Democrat coalition, we've seen rents soar, tuition fees trebled, nurses' bursaries scrapped, nurses going to food banks, solar energy investment cuts and slashed away, war waged on our junior doctors. We've reneged on our commitment to resettling refugees. Our local councils have been crippled by cuts. Over 50% of the council budget here in Barnet has been removed by the government, and they are now having to provide the same services with greater demand and much less investment from our government. And house building has fallen to the lowest levels since the 1920s. And all the while, the government has been offering multinational corporations tax breaks and sweetheart deals. Now, the Labour Party has been accused in the last few weeks of wanting to take Britain back to the 1970s. I look at the Conservative manifesto with more austerity that will cripple our most vulnerable, further suppression of our trade unions, bringing back fox hunting, forcing landlords to check tenants' immigration status, leaving millions of EU nationals in limbo because they will not give them the simple guarantee that they will have the right to stay, and they want to scrap the Human Rights Act. When I read that list, I think it sounds positively Victorian, and that's not a world that we should be looking to go back to. And the Labour Party is offering an alternative, and there's nothing backward about our vision for the future. We want one where children are not saddled with £45,000 to £50,000 worth of student debt on graduating university. We want one where we raise the minimum wage, where we ensure that parents and grandparents aren't facing a future with social care being their number one concern. They will not be able to pass on what they've worked their entire lives to provide for their children. One where refugees are welcomed in our communities, not scapegoated as the problem. And one where we build 1 million new homes, invest in our economy to make sure it works for everyone, for the many, not the few. We want a government that thinks about the people it represents. And that is why I'm asking you to vote for me next week when you go to the ballot box. Thank you.
Good evening. I hope I'm using the microphone properly. This is the first time I've ever done a hustings. But let's get on with it. Yeah. Okay, I'm Phil Fletcher. As you can see, I'm the Green Party candidate. I grew up in East Barnet and went to East Barnet Grammar School, which gives you an idea of how old I am. In 1973, I went to Germany and stayed there for 25 years. In that time, I worked as a carpenter, a computer operator, a translator, and an English teacher for adults, and I also spent 3 years working on an organic farm in Bonn. I also lived in Chile for 3 years, where I worked voluntarily as a caretaker in a school for underprivileged children who are actually quite intelligent. And I was a woodwork teacher, and I bought some land and I had a go at developing it, but that's another story. That's enough of my personal life. I returned to this country back in 2005, and I helped restart Barnet Friends of the Earth, and I had been a member of Dessau Friends of the Earth, which is in East Germany, famous for Kurt Weill, if you've ever heard of him. I have also been actively involved in a number of Barnet pressure groups, such as the Pink and Way Alliance, the Barnet Cyclists for a time. I was also in Free and Barnet Library, and I was on the board of the Barnet Countryside Centre. And I joined the Green Party in 2010. And last election, where we incidentally came third, so it's not necessarily a wasted vote if you vote for the Greens, Duncan. I did a campaigning on air pollution, which is at that time was hardly considered worthwhile noting. And this managed to prompt Barnet Council into actually securing funding for 3 residents' associations to do their own air pollution testing. Nitrogen dioxide, nitrogen dioxide tubes around schools, Red Cross development area, and also where there are pending infrastructure projects such as the waste dump in Abbots Way in New South Wales. So we did have an air pollution meeting here in this church on March the 23rd. We did get quite high support from other parties, and hopefully this will lead to more concrete action, whatever party you belong to, in Barnet, so that we can achieve something about air pollution, which is a really serious problem in this city. At a national level, we Greens, we consider climate change to be the most important issue of our time, because it affects us all, whether we like it or not. But at the moment, our problem is Brexit, which has been foisted on us by the right-wing press and Conservative government pandering to UKIP, basically, and a right-wing press and the BBC. Our position has all along been to stay in the EU, and together with like-minded organisations across Europe, to fight for a more democratic and unbureaucratic and environmentally friendly Europe. But that's what our position was. And the actual referendum, the debate so-called, was absolutely woefully inadequate. Focusing on immigration, and was even actually dishonest about the 350 billion it's akin to buying a used car and not being told about the brake fluid system being faulty and leaky, almost. And even very badly managed, because the 6 weeks before, on the Today programme, it was announced that there was no think tank working on a possible scenario for Brexit in agriculture, and that was 6 weeks before the referendum. And that's very, very bad planning. Okay, now, many of the ills in our society, such as the cuts to the NHS and education, which we all know about, are basically, the root cause of this is a really, really bad and unfair taxation system. And a situation which is actually, I would say, obscene, where the more and more wealth is being concentrated into fewer and fewer hands. And we want a fair taxation system, we want a fairer society. For example, the HMRC, they estimate that £30 billion is not collected in tax, and I wonder if you would like to name any of the tax havens that have been closed down. We also think we have been paid with a Tobin tax, which we proposed first of all, which thankfully the Labour Party have taken up. This is a minuscule amount of money would be paid for any transaction. And also a land valuation tax, which is basically, if implemented properly, with enough, as there's so much tax that is not approved, not collected in this tax, so much land is not taxed, would actually replace council tax, depending on the amount of the tax.
For 12 years, I've been standing up for Barnet and the people who live here, campaigning on the issues that matter here, such as protecting the green belt and our local environment, improving public transport, backing our local NHS services, and supporting local high streets and local businesses and local jobs. I have a track record of getting results on issues which matter to all of us who live here. So I spoke out against expected hikes in business rates because of revaluation. And the Chancellor listened to what ILOs had to say, and a major package of support for small businesses was announced in the budget. I also protested about plans for quarterly reports to the tax authorities, and the government has postponed them for smaller businesses for a year.
And I was part of the successful resident-led campaign to renovate and reopen East Barnet Health Centre, and I persuaded TfL to keep the vital 107 bus when it came under threat when Hertfordshire Council withdrew funding. Those are just a taste of a few of the campaigns in which I've been involved over the last 12 years. I live in the constituency, and I will always be a strong local champion for Barnet and its different communities. So I've highlighted very often the international causes, which are close to the hearts of many in this great diverse borough of ours. Issues such as freedom for Cyprus, peace and security for Israel, justice for Tamils in Sri Lanka, and action on human rights in Iran. And of course, I'm sure someone this evening will point out that yes, I did vote differently to many in this constituency on the European Union referendum. And I want to take this issue head on. While I voted to leave, if I'm re-elected, I will be listening to the views of the whole community, whether they voted leave or whether they voted remain. It's in the interest of all of us, whichever side we chose in the summer last year, that we now make a success of the decision that this country made in the referendum. And the Conservative plan for a successful Brexit is for an outward-looking UK, engaging internationally, trading globally, and shaping a new partnership with our European neighbours, with which I hope the majority of both Leave and Remain voters can feel comfortable. And I want to be very clear that I fully accept how crucial it is that we secure the rights of the 3 million EU nationals living here and the 1 million UK nationals living in the EU, and that we give them certainty as soon as we can. And in Parliament, I've spoken out and urged the government to make that one of the highest priorities for the negotiations. And my greatest goal in politics is a strong economy, because almost every other political objective depends on achieving that. I want a strong economy so that living standards go up for people in this constituency, so that young people get the jobs they want and the chance to go as far as their talents and their hard work can take them. So we can keep taxes on ordinary working people as low as possible, and so we can fund the NHS, the police, our schools, the armed forces, and all the other public services we value. For nearly 4 years, I served at the highest level of government and was part of a team which has delivered economic recovery and stability and roughly 1,000 new jobs for every day the Conservatives have been in office. We've cut income tax for 31 million working people. We've reduced the deficit by about 2/3. It's 40 years since unemployment was this low, and we are investing record amounts in the NHS with more doctors and nurses than at any time in its 68-year history, handling more operations, more A&E visits, and more treatments than ever before. Only a vote for the Conservatives can lock in the economic progress we've made, and I appeal to you for your support on June the 8th. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the candidates. Thank you to the candidates for their opening speeches. That's question number one. I didn't speak to you when you arrived. Are you here? Okay, I will ask the question on their behalf. The first question is, do you agree that once the terms of Brexit are known, the British people should be able to decide either through Parliament or a referendum whether they wanted to leave or remain in the EU? So I'll ask that again. Do you agree that once the terms of Brexit are known, the British people should be able to decide either through Parliament or a referendum whether they wanted to leave or remain in the EU?
The 24th of June 2016 was a day that my heart broke for this country. The decision to leave was heartbreaking, but we were presented with a binary choice on what has, in the last 12 months, been very clear, not a binary decision. The single market wasn't on the ballot paper last summer. The customs union wasn't on the ballot paper last summer. Immigration wasn't on the ballot paper last summer. This is an issue that should never have been left to referendum politics that has become so popular from the Liberal Democrats and other parties. This was a decision that absolutely should have been taken in Parliament with people who were informed and knew the consequences of the outcome. And it certainly should not have been fought with people standing in front of buses with promises of money for the NHS that we found out the morning after were a lie. I think that we need to have a vote with the outcome of this decision making and negotiating. But that decision needs to be made by the people who have all of the information, where it cannot be misled or lied to us in the media, where the people who are making that decision are our parliamentarians, but they are listening and listening acutely to their constituents. My MP, and I do live just over the border in Hornsey and Green, listened to her constituents last summer. She voted against triggering Article 50. And if I felt, as your MP, that the feeling of this constituency was that it was the wrong deal, then I would vote with your thoughts in mind and not my own. Not my own ambition, not my own principles, but the thoughts of this constituency, because this decision is far too important to be based on the feelings of 650 MPs. It needs to be based on those MPs talking to their constituents and finding out how they feel, but being able to explain to them what is going on. So if I were your MP, I would hold public meetings. I would invite you to come and tell me what you think about it, and I would answer your questions about it, so that I felt that you were informed and that you felt I was informed about how you felt about the outcome of our negotiations. Thank you.
Well, one thing we need to ask ourselves is, there was a slogan, take back control, but for whom? Is this for large corporations or for the British people as a whole? Because as I'm in the period after the referendum, there was such limited scope of discussion, and wide aspects were simply left out. I mean, I don't suppose anybody here would want to vote for if there's going to be any reduction in environmental standards. Nobody here wants to vote for swimming in sewage in the beaches, for example, because those are, that's EU legislation. And also, interestingly, a lot of parts around the country that were reliant on EU money voted against, so we have to ask ourselves why. We have to ask ourselves about the press in this country. Why have we got such a right-wing press? I know for a fact that the press in Germany is a lot more balanced. And, for example, more Germans know about trade deals such as CETA and TTIP, and I'm pretty certain a lot of people here don't even know what CETA, which is the Comprehensive Economic Trade Agreement, which is on which any future trade deals may be based. And this involves secret courts, which would allow corporations to sue any governments. So therefore, the NHS, if the NHS has been privatised, or you want to take back British Rail in public ownership, that company could sue the British government if they did so. And of course, what we need now is to have proper scrutiny of Brexit. And we, the Greens, hopefully get at least one more MP in Parliament. And a vote for the Greens may not be wasted, because we would be getting short money for every vote we get. And that's what happens. And so we can put this money to good use, and we can be doing some really efficient scrutiny, as any efficient opposition should be doing. And we are also in favour of a referendum, because we think that's often because we think that is only democratic and fair. Okay.
So long as we remain members of the EU, we vest supreme lawmaking power in people we do not elect, we cannot remove, and we cannot easily influence. I think that needs to change, because I think our democracy needs to be revitalised, and I think we can look forward to a bright future as an independent nation once again. I believe that the final deal should be voted on in Parliament. I do not believe a second referendum is justified. It's not acceptable for the establishment to come along and say you have to vote again on a result because we didn't like the result that we got the first time round. The decision has been made. I believe we should respect the decision of the British people that they made last year in the referendum. More people voted to leave in this country than have ever voted for anything else ever in the long history of British democracy.
Of any politician who does not acknowledge that you were tricked and misled last summer. Question of integrity. How is it to represent anyone in the UK? Because that referendum was sensible, rational people like yourself taking decisions on the basis of information that later prove not to be true. They have the power now to acknowledge that this was not true, and still some of them do not do so. Question whether such a person is fit to represent you. Now, I'm not saying vote for me. I'm saying just ask that question. Now, the question was, do you deserve a vote on the final deal? The answer that I will give is yes, without doubt. It affects your life. It affects your job. It affects your weekly shop. It affects your rights. It affects your safety, where you travel, where you live in the future. The final say should rest with you, the people. Public meetings, they're not attended by very many people. Even the public meeting here, large as it is, probably the largest in Barnet, will not touch 1% of the people. We need better democracy than this, particularly after the disgraceful way that we have all been misled last summer. Some of you will ask, what is the role of our MPs? Well, the proposal from the Prime Minister is an extreme form of Brexit. It's an extreme form of Brexit in which the rights of EU nationals and those of UK citizens in the EU will not necessarily be protected, where people will be uprooted the way they were, are being with the bedroom tax. All sorts of people, at the moment, underprivileged people, people who are less well off, are the victims. Now, they will turn victims into all sorts of people. Many people of this congregation have told me of their relatives. They will be turned into the victims. First they came. Now they will come for others. Free movement of people. At the moment, your relatives have the right to work all over the EU. Consider over the next few months whether you'd like that to continue or whether not. Whether the opportunities for young people to write and work abroad matter to you. I will fight for those rights. Consider whether equalities, maternity leave, annual leave, these kinds of rights matter for you. I will fight for UK law to match European standards. Will the other candidates do so? Consider trade. Consider the membership of the single market. Consider whether you believe that any of the parties present will be able to negotiate for you. I have been involved in trade for a major retailer across the world. I know how complex this is. Put me there in Parliament, I will negotiate for you. I have done it on a commercial scale before. I don't believe that many others have. Scientific research, it drives our economy. It is really driving our economy now, invisible. But you know that technology is moving forward. You know how important medical research is. I will protect that for you. There are many more areas I could speak of. I said that Chris would like me to not speak of them now. I'll speak of them later. But remember, we're talking about the future here. We're talking about those cures for those illnesses which are currently incurable. Do you really want to cut their research funding at the knees? And don't you want someone who's been active in research standing up for you?
Actually, yes.
I just wanted to briefly respond. I was always very clear when I was talking about the 350 million claim that it was a gross figure, that we got some of it back via our rebates and through our subsidies, etc. I was clear in this very church when we were lining about on this issue. This was a figure that was exclusively, extensively scrutinised.
Expensive because
it's a reality that we do send £10 billion net to the EU, and it's about time we brought those £10 billion back.
It's
been on our minds.
I just wanted to respond very quickly to what Ms. Ray said, where she said she would absolutely call for a referendum. I note her quote today in the Barnet Times, where she is quoted as saying it would be unwise to commit to a second referendum too soon. Which is it?
Oh, God.
I would like a vote of all the people. That could be a referendum, but at the way the instability of the current government and the instability of the political parties, who knows? They might call another general election. They keep telling you that they're not going to, and then they do so. But I would like a vote of all the people. A referendum will do, but I think we may need a general election because the parties are not up to much that who are contending for, to lead the country at the moment, neither the opposition nor the Prime Minister.
Wow. Okay, that's a backstone, guys.